I'm here to talk about Ultravans and Tiarnas, the Ultravan Club, and Hutchinson, and a little bit about how Ultravan became Valco, became Collins, but I don't really know much about Collins. Collins experts are in the back here. That's a good start, I guess. If you don't have one of these brochures that the museum made for us, please take one, because they're awesome. I also need to preface this by saying thank you, especially to Christy Barden, who put together the original Whales on Wheels newsletter and interviewed Dave Peterson, and he was just into recording all of the history he could find and putting it in the newsletter. And to Norm Helmke, who took the initiative to get all the old newsletters collected and into a club archive where I can find them, so that's where most of this information comes from. And of course, to the wonderful people of Hutchinson who built these coaches for us. You can't talk about Ultravans without talking about Dave Peterson. Dave Peterson was born in 1914 in Minnesota. He moved to Blackwell, Oklahoma in 1929 with his family. He was 15 and his father died almost immediately thereafter. His father was a carpenter and a part-time preacher who taught Dave woodworking skills, and Dave had to use those woodworking skills to help his mother pay rent. He did odd jobs basically in the high school woodshop. At 16, he took plans out of Popular Mechanics magazine and built a wooden glider. He taught himself to fly, and about 30 other men taught themselves to fly. One of the local carpenters didn't like him using the high school woodshop, though. He didn't like him being competition, so he got him kicked out, and Dave opened Dave's Woodwork Shop in Blackwell, Oklahoma. 5 years later, he married Lucille, and they moved to Tulsa, where he worked for about six different companies in the middle of the Depression. One of those was Spartan Aircraft. And then he moved to Wichita, which is where Lucille was from, to work for Stearman Aircraft. He got these jobs one of the things that he did with Dave's woodwork shop was repairing wooden airplanes at the time. So aviation woodworking is what got his start, and being an entrepreneur, opening his own businesses. Okay, so he's working for Stearman Aircraft in Wichita. The Depression is kind of getting a little bit better. He buys the number 35 Beechcraft Stagger Wing from Walter Beech, and opens his own charter aircraft service while he's still working for a Stearman. And then the war comes along and his airplanes are confiscated for the war. And he goes to work for Boeing Aircraft, where he is final assembly manager for the B-29 project. Boeing also sends him to Seattle to learn to fly multi-engine airplanes. He flies B-17s up there, B-17 bombers. And he comes back to fly B-29 bombers, but they kind of wanted him to manage, and he wanted to be the flyer, so that he ended up working for Sinclair Oil Company as their first company pilot, and became their chief pilot eventually. And while he was doing that was in Tulsa again. He moved back down to Tulsa. While he was doing that, he opened Rent-A-Plane, where he was renting out Beechcraft Bonanza airplanes. And he thought there was a market for a twin-engine Bonanza. Beechcraft was already building what they called the Twin Bonanza, but it was a much larger airplane with much larger engines. So he went to Walter Beech and said, I think you should build, basically a Bonanza airplane with the engines on the wings. And they said, thanks, that's a great idea. I think what was happening was they didn't want to tell him they were already working on that. that became the travel air. Anyway, so he went off back to Oklahoma to design and build this airplane himself. It eventually became known as the Super V. The difference between a Super V and a travel air is the travel air has a standard tail and the Super V has a V tail. But they didn't go very far because Beach came out about the same time, and you know, why not buy from a known vendor? But he was able to sell this project to a company called Oakland Air Motive, and he moved out to Oakland, California to support it. And they reached certification in June 17, 1960. In July of 1960, Dave started planning this. He's now living in Oakland, California. He has a family, has a wife, a son and a daughter, and I assume a house, and a boat, and a Spartan trailer. And he's driving down to Mexico one day, and he thinks, geez, I wish I could have didn't have to decide between the trailer and the boat. And he started thinking about how to make a motorhome. At that time, there wasn't really any such thing as a production motorhome. The first motorhome was built in 1958 by Ray Frank, who thought up the name motorhome. Before that, they were travel cars and various other names. But none of them were really production. They were more or less one-off custom fabrication. So in September 1st, of 1960, Dave rented a garage in Oakland, California, and started building this. He built this car between, or this Ultraman, it was eventually registered as a 1960 house car. He built it from September 1st to January 2nd. 1969. Drove it to the DMV and got it licensed and registered on January 2nd. You can see it's not quite an Ultraman. He basically wanted to put an engine in the Spartan trailer, but he came across this Corvair drivetrain setup. And it was so perfect that he wanted to use it, but it would never push a Spartan down the road, so he designed his own vehicle. The vehicle ended up being 24 feet long. Ours are mostly 22 feet long. 8 foot wide, 8 foot high, 1,800 pounds empty. So it was 5 times the interior volume of a VW bus, but 400 pounds lighter than a VW bus. And a lot more horsepower. His was built with a wrecked 1960 Corvair sedan that he found, which I think had an 80 horse engine. Volkswagens would have been what, 35 horsepower?
Yeah. What year?
1960.
36 horsepower.
So this is the number one Ultraman. Number 101. He didn't really have a sequential serial number plan at this point. And he drove it around California and said, ooh, that people would say, ooh, that's really neat, where can you get one? So the light bulb went off. So he didn't want to be in production. He was an idea man, and he wanted other people to worry about production. So he started sending out these prospectuses. The Norm Helmke has one that had the date of August 24th, 1961, stamped on it, where he said, this is my concept, these are the people involved, this is what it's going to take to invest in producing these. He used the name Ultravan for a commercial van with nothing inside it, Ultravan Conestoga for a basic camper, or some, he also called it the Conestoga camper. And then the deluxe Conestoga would have been the upgraded camper, which even then he expected to only weigh 2,690 pounds. these pictures are both, these renderings are both from the perspectives. This was a little bit later, and we'll get into that. This was 1962. He filed for a patent for the distinctive shape of a vehicle, which he received in 1964. But I kind of like putting all the old drawings in one spot. So, but he knew the number one was not going to be a productionizable vehicle. So he came up with something slightly different that definitely looks like an Ultraman. There's some changes. Those of us who own them will know that this Ford Econoline headlights were changed out to a single headlight later on. So he built number two, which at the time he called the demo van. Didn't really have a serial number. Eventually it became known as number 200. And he built number three, or number 103, which is this one. So the first customer delivery was in the summer of 1962, and I found an old ad that said that Dr. Watson was selling this coach a couple years later, and he said it originally cost me $9,500. So we know what the price was when you bought it. This is number 103, which is now in Big Bear, California. And he took the demo coach to the 19th annual San Francisco National Sports and Boat Show, February 1st through 10th, 1963. Oh, but before that, he drove the coach to Dearborn, Michigan to show it to GM. And to arrange to have drivetrain, to purchase drivetrains from him and try to get them to build it, which obviously didn't happen. And they said, well, this is great. We should have you go in the Silver Book, which was a book that they sent out to truck dealers to show what was available to order, not from GM, but from third parties. So the sales brochure was in the 1963 Silver Book, and then was distributed at the Sports and Boat Show. I'm not sure whether he started number four before. I'm not sure when number four got started, but number four was built as a commercial van to display light fixtures for a lighting company that were going to take it to trade shows. And that's the next slide. Also, I found a thing that said we're in 1963, Clark Equipment had him come out to consult on trying to reduce the weight of the Cortez motorhome before it went into production. And so he's got his hand in all this stuff. Eventually you'll see he was involved with the FMC motorhome and the Clark Cortez, and there were three or four different companies that tried to get Ultraman started again after Hutchinson ended. That's down the road. Everybody thoroughly confused yet? Okay, so he's building this light display van for Presco Light Corporation, and they like it so much that they say, hey, we'll build it for you. So now there's Presco Light Manufacturing Corporation, Motor Coach Division of San Leandro, California, which lasted about a year. And they built, we're not really sure, maybe five coaches. This is a picture of number 163102, which is known as the Green Machine. This coach was identified as number 103 before it burned, but it looks almost identical to the Green Machine. And obviously 103 is the other 103, so I think it was probably serial number 163103. The Presco Light numbers are like that. Presco Light had the interiors built by Custom Trim Aircraft Interiors at the Hayward Airport, or the Municipal Airport at Hayward Hayward Airport. It's basically headliner fabric material. And they had these great ideas that they were going to change the coach and sell it as a travel on and not have to pay Dave anymore. That didn't work out. Dave didn't like that. So on February 27th, 1964, Prescolite shut their doors. Any questions so far? That was, we think, coaches 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and 11. But we've never been able to see any trace of at least two of those. So which one was in which order, it's kind of questionable. Anyway, at the end of Prescolite, Dave was kind of frustrated. So he decided to start over again. He made some redesigns to the coaches. And started production again, starting in number 201. So you'll see my number 5 out, number 500 out there, and you'll say, later on you're going to say, but he said there's only 376 made. Yeah, that's because they restarted at 200 after there were like a dozen made. So there's basically nothing between 1 to 199. This is the wooden warehouse building in Alameda, California, 366 8th Avenue. It's no longer there. Up until very recently, it was still there. He built number 200, number 103, number 104, then the Prescolite activity was down there, and then he started again with number 201 in the same building, went all the way up through 213 in the same building. And in fact, he went back into the same building after Hutchinson closed. He's still on his stationary all the way, almost to the very end. So these coaches were slightly different. They had, the whole corner was molded. No, that's not a good example. The whole corner was molded. On the older ones, it was molded from here, and then it was sheet metal at the bottom. He brought it down to 22 feet with a few exceptions. He got rid of the stainless or the chrome pickup truck bumpers, and he went to the foam bumpers that mostly don't exist anymore because they never lasted very well. Number 201 and number 203 still have the chrome bumpers. 201 is a 24 foot, 203 is a 22 foot, so it's possible that those were left over from the Prescolite effort and he just slotted them into production. This is 202 though, and it shows the distinctive, the length. Mostly the increased length is shown up here and in a wider window. This is 203 and this is 200.
Hold on.
Yeah.
I know that his prototype had integral tanks.
Yes. I don't know when he stopped doing that.
Okay.
I don't know when he stopped doing that. Some of the Prescolite coaches have separate tanks. The Green Machine has separate tanks. The Green Machine is very advanced. The front corners are molded from one piece, which Ultra didn't even catch up to for a couple of years beyond. Using the extrusions instead of bent metal. He's got built-in jacks. I want to get my hands on those sometime and check out all the differences. But I haven't been able to figure out when that started. Anyway, this period is 1963 to early 65. Dave's building, he's basically buying materials to build 10 coaches at a time. This one was called number 108. But we think it was actually 208. It was 27 feet long. It was built for a man and his wife and their mistress. We don't know what that was about, but it didn't last very long. This is number 20. Well, this is 211, which is where Jack Tillotson comes in, or Mr. T, John Tillotson comes in. This is number 206, which obviously was the photo model for the front cover of the color brochure that Ultra publishes. What you can't really see here is that they've got these Econoline headlights here. There's no window in the door. I think this was retrofitted. They've got the long kitchen windows. they've moved the water heater for, or the furnace from this side of the coach to this side of the coach. So they're getting pretty close to the final production Ultraband configuration. Also, now we've got, instead of the early model Corvairs of 1960 to 1964 with a swing arm suspension that Ralph Nader really didn't like, now we've got 1965 to 69 Corvairs, which have a trailing arm suspension, which is less problematic. So some of these coaches have the original swing arm rear suspension, and some of them have the late model Corvair suspension installed backwards as a leading arm suspension, which I have no idea why he would have tried to do that, but that's what he did. Up through number 209 at least had the leading arm suspension. So he's working away in Oakland, building basically up through the 24th or so coach. And meanwhile, Mr. T, John Tillotson Sr., has sort of retired out of his magazine company in Kansas City and bought an RV to start touring the country. And he ends up on Dave Peterson's doorstep. And he says, "Wow, my RV is not so good, this one's much better." Dave was looking for an investor, and there's Mr. T. This is Mr. T. Mr. T's business. John and Clara Tillotson established the Work Basket magazine, which was published from 1935 to 1996. It was a needlework pattern newsletter and then magazine that was a direct mail subscription, which I'm not exactly sure how that works, but that's what they did. And it expanded into Workbench and Flower and Garden magazine. They were in Kansas City. Mr. T was trying to go into retirement, and Jack, John Jr., was trying to get him into retirement. So they all thought that it would be a good idea for him to have this side business instead of bothering Jack at the publishing company. That's my interpretation of it. So, they're obviously not going to build these in Oakland, California, because it's insanely expensive out there, even in the 60s. And also because the Tillotsons are from Kansas City. So they start looking around. This may be out of order. Yeah, let's go to the next one first. They start looking around for a place to build these Ultravans. And apparently, family in Hutchinson, for those of you who don't know, called the Dillons, and if you've seen Dillon Food Store, that's who they were. They were community leaders in this area, and they knew of this vacant tract out in the countryside south of Hutchinson, California. And Dave Peterson had, while he was a charter pilot, had found their uncle who had died in the Rockies. One of the first search and rescue by air efforts in history. So Dave knew the Dillons because he was involved in that. And I'm sure at one point he was talking to them and mentioned that they were looking for a facility, and the Dillons told him. So that's how they came to Wichita. I don't have any records that show that, but that's the story. So, or not Wichita, Hutchinson. So in 1945, this naval air base was constructed for World War II. There were hangars over here, the towers over here. There's what they call the drill hall over here. Here's a later version. After the war, the Navy obviously left. The Air National Guard was here instead. You can see the big round top hangars here and the drill hall over here. Most people think that the Ultraman factory was a airplane hangar. It was not. It was a drill hall. It wasn't even close to the runway. The only time you'd ever have airplanes in there is when you have a tornado or hail coming, and you didn't have room to hide all the airplanes in the big hangars. Anyway, this building was empty. till it's in a range to start production out here. And in the second half of 1965, they drove one Ultravan, number 211, and trailered two Ultravans, 212 and 213, from Oakland to Hutchinson, and all of Dave's tools and jigs and whatnot out of the wooden hangar in Alameda, and set them up in Hutchinson, at the Hutchinson Air Base Industrial Plant. What am I missing? Anybody? Okay. So far, so good, I guess.
Let's go back.
So Jack Tillotson, or John Tillotson, being a publisher, had connections to other publishers and managed to get the new coach featured in Trailer Life. And they were pretty well covered in family motor coaching, although I'm not sure if that was tricky to do. They put together these lovely brochures, the color brochure and the trifold brochure, and there was a, if you sent away for a color brochure, they'd send you this also. And Dave had been publishing this postcard since probably 1963 or 64. But I just like to show the stuff I've collected, basically. By January of 1966, production started by January of 1966. I missed a couple things, but nothing important. You can see all of these promotional pictures. This one, and this one, and this one, and this one. They're all number 206, which is actually one of the early production, rather than one of the actual Hutchinson production vehicles. This is a Hutchinson production vehicle on its way to the Family Motor Coaching Convention a couple years later. So they set up, what have I got next? I haven't seen this in a couple of days. So they set up production in this big wooden hangar, which is actually a drill hole, not a hangar. It had six basketball courts lined out on the wooden floor. It was a great space for building these Ultravans. We have pictures that they took as promotional stills of the construction. These are some slides that were taken by, I think, Ernie Newhouse or possibly Len Ryerson. A couple years later, you can see these are 1968 dashboards. Some of these will show that these are early production coaches though. And they started building coaches up there. You can see that they had quite an operation going. They had a large number of coaches going at any one time. They're mostly sold as direct sales. Somebody would order a coach and they'd buy it from the company directly. Initially, the sales and corporate management was all in Kansas City. By 1967, they moved it out to downtown Ultra. And at that point, if you took delivery of a coach, he took delivery in downtown Hutchinson. I don't think they ever sent customers out to the airbase track. So the earliest delivery we know of from Hutchinson was May 14th, 1966. A guy from Lawrence, California took delivery of number 214. But number 214 was not a Hutchinson-built coach. We don't know what it was. It was probably built from parts and assemblies that Dave had built in Oakland, because the three coaches that they, they drove one and trailer two of them were full of parts and assemblies. So at the delivery ceremony for 215, which was in June 21st of 1966, there was a little ceremony for the town saying, yay, first Hutchinson built the coach. So we know that that was the first built entirely in Hutchinson. And this gentleman in the back here, Doug Bell, was the owner of number 215 for a good number of years, like 10 years? Know that by May of 1967 they had the sales and service move downtown, and in 1967 another name comes up. It's Ernie Newhouse. Ernie Newhouse purchased an early coach out of the factory. I don't remember what number. Oh, it would have been 220. No, that was for Anderson. I don't remember what number. But he liked it so much he wanted to form a club. So by 1967, they had formed the Ultra Van Motor Coach Club, which at the time was a nonprofit. And that's why we're here today. Because without the club, these things would not be on the road anymore, guaranteed. The first club rally was actually in Enumclaw, Washington, and I have not found any records at all about that rally. It was held in August 3rd, 1967. The first big rally that we know about that we actually have some pictures from, there were 27 Ultra Vans at Knott's Berry Farm in California on October 27th, 1967. That actually made it into a magazine, although I haven't been able to get a hold of that magazine to see what's in it.
Which magazine?
Wheels of Feel. Yeah, it's a little tricky to find. And if it's on eBay and I've already bid, back off.
Okay, so here's some more pictures. This is the 1967 sales office, which, as everybody I think here can recognize, is now the Hutchinson Art Museum, or Art Center. They actually have a different address. It's actually 405 North Washington, but at the time it was 101 West 5th. This building was originally an automobile dealership. I'm not sure. Was it Chevrolet? I don't know. There was an article in the Hutchinson paper very recently where they had those details. But I'm not quite sure. I don't remember a brand name sticking out, so it may have been used cars. I'm not sure. There were a lot of businesses in there both before and after. And when I contacted the Hutchinson Art Center, they'd never heard of Ultraman, so this is all good. I mean, all this stuff coming back into Hutchinson is just tremendous legacy. This is, I think, the south end, which I think we drove up past here and then turned right. So we drove up this way and turned over this way. There are some differences. They've changed the building over the years. Some things are bricked up, but some things were already bricked up at that time. So hard to tell exactly what. This picture was actually 1969. And I'm not 100% sure, but I think that's a Tiara right there. That slide was taken by Len Ryerson when he took delivery of the very first V8 Ultra, which, I didn't mention before, when the factory went into production, they went to a trailing arm configuration on the Pro Bears, on the Pro Bear coaches. So somewhere around 68 or so, people knew that there weren't going to be any Corvairs made anymore. So the people out at the Ultra factory knew that they were going to have to come up with something else. What they eventually came up with was the V8 Ultra Van. It's not really easy to tell a lot of differences. The first couple of V8 Ultra Vans are different from the rest of the V8 Ultra Vans. that they basically put a 307 Chevy small block in the back, turned around backwards with the drive shaft running forward into a boat drive and then running back to the axle. And the fan actually pulled, the radiator was in the back of the coach, and the fan actually pulled the air from the back of the coach and exhausted it underneath, which wasn't terribly efficient, but people who have reversed the van have, fan haven't found really much better performance anyway, so it worked. I mean, that's what matters, right? Oh, they also, while they were working on the V8 Ultravan, over the years, a lot of Ultravan owners wanted things like power steering, power brakes, engine-driven air conditioning, and there just wasn't any way to do it on the Ultravan. Ultravan was not designed to be that heavy or elaborate of a vehicle. So, I know Lou was telling me that when he started work at Ultra in 1968, there was a Toronado in a shed with no engine in it. So they were already working on it. Eventually they came up with the Tierra, which was, this is the prototype here. This is Chuck Burgess right here, who was the lead engineer at Ultravan. He, I'm not sure when he started, but I think maybe 67. He was an engineer. He worked for Luscombe Aircraft before the war. He was a German national. And when the war broke out, a lot of German nationals left America to go back to Germany. He stayed. And he helped keep Luscombe Aircraft going during the war. Which is something he's much better known for than his time at Ultra. But he designed basically the Tierra. He hand-built the molds, the jigs, some of the corner pieces, some of the original compound curved corner pieces, supervised the building of the bonding jig. I mean, it was a big deal. And this coach was deluxe. It was half again the cost of an Ultravan. And a $15,000 motorhome in 1969 was kind of a big deal. But it weighed a little bit more than an Ultravan, but had at least double the horsepower. Front wheel drive, Oldsmobile Toronado drivetrain. You could have an engine driven air conditioner, you could have a roof air conditioner, you could put a generator in the back. So, and you can see it was debuted in this magazine here. They put together some more brochures. This one, gentleman brought us one to look at yesterday. They put out a new postcard. And they started building world's first cardiac care ambulance. Deliberate design, you know, not converted from something else. Which was eventually delivered to the Seattle, Washington. But they were having problems meeting payroll. Apparently every coach that went out the door went out with about $2,000. Basically money something to it. And Jack Tillotson, who was never really into this so much himself as he was into getting his dad out of his hair, I think, was tired of covering the difference. So he said, we need to do something about this. And the story I heard was that Lou and Larry Knipe went to meet with him, and Larry Knipe, who was the sales manager, later became mayor of Hutchinson twice. He said, I know I can sell a lot more of these if we just drop the price. And Lou said, but we're already losing money. And Jack said, so shut it down. So they shut down the factory in June of 1970. Got the date here, June 25th of 1970, sent everybody home, and Lou spent the next weekend, 3-4 days of 14-hour days, going through the inventory and the records of Ultravan,
Ultra Incorporated, trying to figure out how they could make a profitable business out of it. That business eventually became Ken Bircher, Lou Ettinger, Bob Lind, Belco Incorporated. They were still providing parts for Ultraman because they had a whole bunch of parts left over from Ultra, but they were only going to build the Tierra. So they sent, I told you that they moved three coaches from California to Hutchinson to 11, 12, and 13. Well, the contract stipulated that at the end of Ultraman production, Dave would get three coaches back. Lou thinks those were 557, 558, and 559. So that's what he told me a couple years ago. It's hard to have, there's no first-hand paperwork left because, well, we'll get to that. Anyway, Belco went back in the direction of the Tierra. They built about 14, well, they finished the Ultramans that they had going on the line, and the Tierras that they had going on the line, which was about 14 of them, and then they closed the factory. In fact, we had a letter from a lady who took the last delivery, and she was there on that specific day, and she noticed that there wasn't a lot going on, and they said, oh, they're off at lunch or something, and she took delivery, drove away, and a couple of weeks later, she noticed that the letter that she got that said that Ultra was closing down was the same day. So Belco went back into production with the Tierra, and they did pretty well with it. The trick was, the only way to get Belco going was to get financing from Jack Tillotson. Jack was happy to be able to write one last check and not have to worry about it anymore, so he wrote him a check. He also took a Tierra, which as far as I know, he still has. So, I'm going to have to back up here. Well, maybe this is better here. So, ultimately, Hutchinson produced 346 Ultramans, not including the last three, but including the first three, so it kind of evens out. 42 Tierras and 2 Ultra Rovers. We don't know where those came from. Those were possibly similar to the Tierra, but they were on truck chassis. All we know about them is Larry Knight was trying to sell them. We got some drawings and offers from Larry. But by 1971, business was starting to get kind of sparse on the Tierra, and Belco was looking for some work to keep their, they were closed for like 3 days, and they hired back most of a good percentage of the workers almost immediately to start building Tierras again, and later got to like 150, 160 employees, something like that, which was very close to what the maximum Ultra Incorporated employee staff was. But by 1971, things were getting kind of thin. I'm not sure because it was competitors or the oil crunch, which didn't really hit hard until 1973, so I'm not sure that's the right explanation. There was a guy in Kansas City named Bob Collins, Don Collins, who wanted to build buses, short buses, smaller capacity buses, and he built one in his apartment complex parking lot under a 2x2 and plastic sheet tent. It was basically a converted, I think it was a Chevy, I'm not 100% sure, but I think it was the Chevy that came out after the Greenbrier. So he had this design, and he had a lot of schools that were interested, but he didn't have any production facility. He also had a salesman, and the salesman had heard of
Medic One, which was this cardiac care ambulance. So he came out to Hutchinson and talked to Belko, and Belko said, well, we'll build some buses. Well, actually, I think they built ambulances first under contract for Collins in 1971. And that worked out so well that by 1972, Collins had purchased certain assets of the Belko Corporation, including most of the staff, some of the tooling, and the facilities, and merged together to form Collins Bus Company, or possibly Collins Industries. Collins Industries. And Belko continued until 1974 selling parts. Basically, they moved the parts into a spare building and started building ambulances and buses. So, I showed you the final tally there. By 1972, they had stopped building Tierras. They were now only building Collins vehicles. But Collins was building these vehicles in the main Ultraman, what had been the main Ultraman. 1980, the wooden factory built burned down. We all heard this story from Ron earlier this afternoon, or Lou earlier this afternoon. Probably started in the electrical department. It was on a weekend, so nobody's really sure exactly what happened. But Collins rebuilt a plain steel building in the same footprint of the original drill hall. You can see they also built new metal buildings in the same footprint of most of the other buildings that the Navy had originally built. Some of them probably burned, some of them they just tore down because it didn't make any sense to keep going. So, but like I say, Collins, I think it was almost immediate that he started rebuilding the building. Collins was a going concern, starting with the Belko employees and knowledge and tools and facilities. So, in a way, Ultra continues today. They're still building buses in South Hutchinson under the Collins Bus Company name. And that has a direct, not a legal, not a corporate identity that goes direct to Ultraman, but it's the same people in the same facilities. So, we're really glad to be able to be here. And we're really glad that you built such cool coaches that they're still around 50 years later. Now the rest of the story is Dave Peterson got his Ultravans back. Go ahead.
It's kind of personal in number.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so the story of Hutchinson was 215.
Yes. And that was roughly number 24.
Okay, they went to 299, so there's 15 through 99.
They went 215 through 556.
Using every number?
Yes. No, they went 201 through 556 using every number.
Okay, I didn't know if they stopped at like 275 and then went to 300.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so
it's complete from 201 to 556.
Okay.
What are these worth today?
Well, it varies an awful lot. You can find $1,500 projects all day long.
Projects?
Yeah.
Based on the single line.
Uh-huh. You can find...
66 and 67.
Well, thank you for coming. You're the people that we're here to talk to. What are they worth today? The highest I've ever seen one go for is 25. And that was a pretty nice coach, which is currently not running because it didn't last.
They started the Tornado engines.
Uh-huh.
Went out there. It was experimenting.
Mm-hmm. So sometime around 68 or so?
66 and 67.
That early? Okay. Okay. There was one Ultraman that was converted. It was originally was number 557, which was the last production coach, 556. That was converted to a front-wheel drive Toronado in the front. But we're not entirely sure whether that was done here or done after Peterson got it, or exactly what happened.
It happened here. Yeah.
Okay. Would that have been at downtown Ultra or out at the factory?
What?
Would that have been in town, downtown here, or would it have been out at the factory?
I'm not aware of anything downtown.
Well, they had sales and service down here.
Well, I'm not aware of any of that.
Okay.
It was all at their base.
Okay. That's good to know. There's a guy that in Iowa who owns that coach now, but somebody ripped the motor and suspension out of it, so it's basically just a shell. Anyway, Peterson got these coaches back, and he wanted to go back into production, but he wanted to, you know, he was aware of all the limitations of the Ultravan, too. He initially came up with a way to put an Ultramobile Toronado drivetrain into the back of an Ultravan with a radiator on the side, and he offered this as a conversion, and he also published a postcard which, if you find an Ultravan postcard for sale, it's probably this version. It'll look like this. And on the back, it'll say it has a Toronado engine. That was never produced. So that's kind of a confusing thing. But he did convert 25, I think, coaches to that configuration, but they were existing coaches. They were not new production. So, and he was, again, trying to get GM to... trying to get GM to do the production. He actually sent some letters to Ed Cole to try and get a sample of the Wankel engine to work with. But let me know that was never going to happen. But he eventually came up with this number 601 coach, or the 600 series coach. As you can see, it's flat-sided. It still uses the same windshield. It's still riveted aluminum construction. It's got a square back instead of a round back. It had a 350 Oldsmobile engine on the side, with a drive shaft running to the back to an offset differential axle. He produced eventually three of them at 23 foot length and two of them at 25 foot length, but he was going to offer them to whatever the customer wanted. Ultimately, these were the only two customer deliveries, 603 and 604. This is Christy Barton's coach. Everybody's seen this one because Jim Craig and Howard Bosa owned it for years. Anyway.
So on Jim Craig's property is
605, which was never finished or delivered to anybody. Yeah. That was a 23 foot. So let me go back a little bit here. 1970, the factory closed. 1970, Belco started up again. November of 1970, Dave offered the 455 conversion. December of 1970, a partnership was announced called Snowbill to develop a new coach. That never happened. January of 1971, the largest rally ever held was held at Lion Country Safari in Irvine, California. They had 66 Ultravans there. Of course, they were still practically brand new. In July of 1971, they had a Coarse Gold rally that a coach that was an original coach number 221 was actually converted to this side engine configuration that was supposed to be there. I don't know whether it ever did or not. And then in August of 1971, Dave announced the Super Ultra Coach, which was still just a drawing, but it was eventually this. Also, that was August of 1971. November of 1971, Belco took a contract to manufacture buses. December of 1971, April of 1972 was the first showing of coach number 601 at the Disney Vacation Land rally. At that rally, Food Motor Coach did a presentation on this cool new Ultraban derived motorhomes that they were going to produce, which looked kind of like this. And the story was, Peterson was under contract with FMC to help them to build the new coach. They actually had their hands on the 601 prototype. I heard that he had to steal it back in the middle of the night after the contract was ended. I don't have any records on that, so I don't know how true it is. But eventually, I think it was at the next rally. Yeah, well, in 1972, they brought renderings of these coaches in 19, 23, and 29 foot lengths. That was July of 1972 to the Monterey Valley Rally. And Dave had a contract that he could not sublicense the Ultraman for 1 year from that date. So he was under contract with FMC. But they eventually went a different way. And next time they came to an Ultraban rally, they showed the new FMC, which some of you may be familiar with. It was a mid-engine Chrysler, big monstrous coach. The Ultraban people were not impressed. But these were prototype. This is a prototype that FMC built with the side engine and a lot of Dave's concept. This was a four-wheel drive motor coach that they also looked at. I'm not sure whether they actually had a prototype or not. But they went a different way. So Dave decided to go it alone again. And he started trying to take investment to get the 600 coaches under production, which happened finally in April of 1973. A man named Roger Dillon, D-I-L-L-A-N, not O-N, invested in the company, which they called the Ultraban Corporation, and they moved out to Sonoma. So Dave had actually been building these in the Alameda warehouse, even at that time. And he actually started these two coaches under contract to customers in the Alameda warehouse. They moved them out to Sonoma to finish them off. 603 was delivered in July of 73, 604 to Ernie Newhouse. Which coaches does Clyde have? Or Christy? I think it was Newhouse. Yeah, I think it was Newhouse. This was under contract for Newhouse. This was under contract for Phil Phillips, who was later a president of the Ultraman Company, but then Ultraman Club, but then he kind of disappeared. Anyway, the Sonoma effort didn't really work out because those were the only two vehicles they produced. We don't really have any records of that company. In March of 1974, the newsletter reports that the factory in Sonoma had been closed. In May of 1974, Belco had an auction for their remaining assets, so that was done. And then in April of 1979, the Collins factory burned down. Missed it. April 22, 1980, excuse me. April 26, 1979. I'm not sure whether that was 79 or 80. Was it 1980? Okay. Yeah, but I put that on there and I put this on here, so I was obviously wrong in one place or the other.
Okay,
so it was 80? Yeah, okay. Okay, and obviously they rebuilt, but at that point, Ultravan was pretty much over. Although later on, Dave built, in his backyard, he built a Chevette-powered Ultravan number 701. Seriously, an inline four-cylinder Chevette engine. But it was the high-output version. Because he thought this whole energy crisis was going to be a pretty big deal, which obviously it was. This is number 701, which also has never been completed. So, what else do I have? Then in October of 1980, 48 Ultravans and one Tiara came to Hutchinson for the first Hutchinson rally. Nobody who came there except that man back there was actually at that rally, I think. Nobody here was actually at that rally.
What year was that?
October 1980. In 1982, the group Ultravan, which was Christy Barden's organization, was approved by the Corsa Corvair Association as group number, as chapter number 002, January 1982. The reason there were two different clubs was because the original Ultravan Motor Coach Club was kind of snooty, and they would not let anybody into their club unless they actually owned it or had owned an Ultravan. And Christy thought that there should be a club for people who liked Ultravan. So he formed the Corsa chapter. Am I going on way too long? I'm almost done.
It's only been an hour.
Has it been an hour already? I'm sorry.
Sorry.
We like it.
1987, Louis Griggs published the historical record. He went through, called every owner that he knew of, found all of the previous owners from the current owners, and published a little yellow book that had all of the known owners that you could find in it. So that was definitely part of one of the seminal moments of the club. September 24th, 1996 was the 30th anniversary Hutchinson Rally, where 34, I think, Ultravans showed up. And there's several people who were at that rally in this room. One of them is right here. He's actually wearing the Ultravan Rally t-shirt from 1996. And where's Jerry? And then Jerry and Mary Lou were also here at one of their first rallies. He's got the same t-shirt, but he wore it 2 days ago. And
one just like it.
Yes.
Not the same. Well, here's one just like it.
And I got a new t-shirt.
Patty.
She walked out.
Oh, she laughed.
And
she
went
out
the
bar. We have t-shirts available.
Yes,
sir. That's silver
coach. Those t-shirts, we have two that are large, men's, and we have many from last year's rally, ladies and men, various sizes.
And I'll finish up here. June 22 of 2000, David Gibson Peterson passed away in San Rafael after a stroke. In 2003, the Ultravan Motor Coach Corporation also joined Corsa as Chapter 8, 008. The 00 chapters are special interest chapters, so there were a lot more chapters than that would suggest. In 2005, the two clubs merged, and Chapter 2, Christy Barden's chapter, was dissolved, but we maintained the Wales on Wheels newsletter. And in 2008, Lucille Peterson passed away. And that's most of what I got. So you can see here, production rate for the Ultravans really hit hard in 67, 68, 69. 66, they were still struggling to get it together. 1970, I kind of fudged those numbers a little bit because I don't really have any Tiara delivery records. In total, there were 320 Corvair-powered Ultravans produced. 347 of the V8 Ultravans, 5 of the Super Ultravans, and 1 Chevette Ultravan, and 42 Tiaras. Although we've only ever found like 20 of them, and the last one we've ever heard of was number 2040. Hi, ma'am.
Hello, how are you?
And that's what I've got. Questions?
Thank you.